Hey, what's up, fam? This is Kendall Talbot, Executive Director of Operations for Hamilton Brothers Media. I'm here today with the founder and CEO of Hamilton Brothers Media, Mr. Fred Hamilton. What's going on, bro?
What's up, bro?
Hey, man, you know how it is. You know what it is, what we do. Say, let's go and get into this thing, man. Hey, you know, let me know what's going on with you, man. What's happening out there with you right now?
So, you know, we're doing Hamilton Brothers Media. And, you know, I started entertainment a long time ago, man. At least getting the buzz of entertainment. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
Getting interested in being into entertainment. Probably goes all the way back to 86, 87, somewhere around in there.
Wow.
I'm a little kid. I'm in junior high. I'm a junior in high school. And my uncle was a lawyer in Philadelphia.
Okay.
And on the summers, I would go up to visit my uncle. One of those summers, I was up there with Unc, and he was a entertainment lawyer. This cat named Schooly D came in. And that's the first time I met Schooly. And me and Schooly got real cool, man. Whenever I would go up to Philly, that would be the person that I would hang with. So this entertainment buzz actually came from him and from a trip with him. So one of those weekends, he was like, they was filming King of New York. And he was like, man, I'm gonna take the train up to New York. You think your uncle will let you, you know, roll up there? So I asked uncle, was like, man, go ahead. So we go up to New York City, and I walk actually into the studio where they're doing the editing for the movie King of New York. And what that's like, if you ever been in a recording studio, you got your booth, you got the board. In the movies, same setup. It's like a mini movie theater where you walk in, you got the screen there, and then you got the board where they mix in, and like somebody walk in the room, they'll hit the sound for the door to make it sound and start pushing the words for the people to start talking. So I'm actually sitting in here looking at them make this movie icon of King of New York. I'm seeing them make it. So that's what really started getting me into the buzz. Now, when I was in Kansas City in the 80s, we used to rap, you know, like everybody else. Everybody thought they could rap. We had a group of cats called the Dons. So I used to rap a lot. And I used to tell Schooly about my rapping, you know. And he said, man, what you got? So he actually did like how I used to write. I've always been a writer. So he used to like how he's like, man, that's good. That's good. He put me on his album, How a Black Man Feel.
Okay.
So he did an album with Capitol Records. This is a funny story how this happened. So I had been saying I could rap, I could rap, I could rap. We in the studio. So Schooly's working on this song, and he gets to the last 16 bars, and he looked through the booth. I'm sitting on the couch, and I'm actually writing some stuff. But I was always writing. When I got bored, I would be writing.
Right.
Schooly was like, hey, come on in the booth. If you want to be on the record, you ready to rap, get in the booth. So in front of everybody in the room, engineers, everybody's in there, go to the roof and spit a 16 bars. If you like it, if everybody in here like it, you're on the record. Spit the 16. Room was like, man, that's jamming. Bam. I'm on Capitol Records, and I'm on his How Black Man Feels album. So that was my first itch. It's another song on that album called Run. And me and Schooly did this song called Run, and it's actually in a movie called Street War that Mario Van Peebles shot. And okay. when the kid is a kid in the projects and some guys are chasing him and he take off running, and that's when that song Run. So I went from never rapping, never being on anything, to a song that's already in the movie.
So your first foray into this this industry came at the hands of one of the originators of what we, you know, so lovingly refer to as gangster rap, Mr. Schoolie D. Your first time out, you're dealing with Schoolie D and who was Abel Ferrer for King of New York and all of these things. So how was that? I mean, as someone that's just coming out, how did that, you know, I guess boost you to even want to do more?
Fortunately for me, I was one of those youngsters that liked to listen. So I soaked up a lot of information around Abel and around Schoolie. And a quick note about Schoolie, there's a editorial called The Village Voice. And I forgot when the article was, but you can look this up. They was writing a story about Schoolie. And the guy who was writing the story mentioned, well, now we got this new genre of music called gangster rap. So the term gangster rap actually comes from an article in the Village Voice written about Schoolie.
About Schoolie. Wow. So he is the true originator of the term, or at least it was attributed to him first. Wow. That's pretty amazing, man. So what went on from there? Where did you guys go from you working with Schoolie and Abel and all of that? What was this in the late 90s, middle 90s?
No, we 91, 92. We're in that range right now. Okay. I mean, I'm just amazed at all the things that are going on around me. I mean, King of New York, you got Wesley Snipes in that, Christopher Walken, Lawrence Fishburne.
Lawrence, man. Wow. That's what I mean, man. Your first entry into that and you dealing with these, man.
My head is spinning looking at all of this stuff that's going on. And another story, when we was working on the How Black Man Feels album, there's a song, Schoolie did this song called Original Gangster.
Okay.
And he did it with KRS-One. When I was a little man, I used, you know, all of the groups that was out back then, the KRS-One, BDP, all of that, I used to jam them. Yeah. It's Melody, you know, all of them, Moni. So he calls me and says, hey, I'm going to put you to working with this one song with me. At that time, I didn't know KRS-One was going to be one of the cats working on it. Fly from Kansas City, New York, picked up at the airport. Schoolie said, meet me at the studio. Go to the studio, sitting in there. I'm starting to listen to the track, trying to come up with some ideas or some things that we can go. Schoolie come in. Next thing I know, I turn around, KRS-One walks in.
Wow.
KRS-One walked in and he goes, hey, what's up? You know, I got on my can. He's like, man, you're Kansas City, New York. You know, I got all this Kansas City stuff on. I'm in New York City. Okay, man, cats don't be running around NYC with Kansas City stuff on. So we start talking about the song. He said, man, I think it should have a Jamaican feel. So he put this loop on and we sitting there listening. He goes, man, I'm hungry, man. You want to go grab something to eat right quick and come back? I said, yeah, let's ride. So this is when I had like an out-of-body experience. I go down KRS-One, got this beat bright red BMW. We rolling in New York City, just me and him. We going to get some fish from some Jamaican spot. And I'm just looking around like, this is crazy.
Yeah, how like you?
I go from seeing this cat on MTV and all this other stuff to kicking it with him, you know? And then 5 minutes, we stopped for me. I forgot we was doing it. Miss Melody came up and him and her was out there talking. He introduced us. Hey, this is my boy from Kansas City. We working on a song, this, that, and the other. So it was crazy, man. It's a whirlwind of stuff was happening so fast. You know what I mean?
Wow. So just a young man from Kansas City. Just, you know, doing his thing, you know, maybe for a hobby or whatever. Now you've been linked to three of some of the most iconic people in the industry, Abel, Ferrer, Schoolie D, and now KRS-One. And these are all first time, you know, on your first time out. That's pretty amazing, man.
First time in the mix, man, in the mix of trying to understand what the industry was. And all this time now, I'm soaking up all this information from schoolie about publishing and mechanicals and copyright. And I'm also learning from Abel about movies and directing, writing scripts. So this is when I started doing all of that stuff that's brought us to Hampton Brothers Media now. But yeah, there was a lot of things that happened, man. So in Kansas City, after that period, I went back home and started a record label. Everything that I had learned, so me and this guy named Isaac Ellis started this record label called So Serious Records. And we were actually the first rappers to ever be like on the radio in Kansas City. So my boy DJ Hank had the DJ Hank hour. He needed an intro, and we put something together for him. So this is the first time I'm hearing myself on the radio all the time. Right. Every time DJ Hank show come on, he got to play us on the intro, you know?
Right.
So we sold some records to Kansas City, man. We was in Seventh Heaven, you know, place like that, but we didn't get pushed over to the edge. So I had to think of how are we going to push this out to the rest of the country, because we're in a small market right now. So I started traveling to places like Houston. So I said, all right, I'm going to move down to Houston for a while, see who I can meet there, see what we can do in Houston. Go to Houston, hooked up with one of my partners, Dion. Dion's cousin was jamming the 7/6 tape that we made on So Serious Records and tells me, hey, man, I'm going to give your tape to this cat named Lil Troy. I had no idea who Lil Troy was at that point. Mm-hmm. Me and Lil Troy met at a gas station one day. I hit him up. I said, man, what you think? He said, man, y'all jamming. What you want to do? I said, I want to make records and put. I said, you ever put anybody out before? He said, yeah, I put Scarface out. So now I'm like, wait a minute. I used to jam Scarface and the Ghetto Boys in Kansas City. You try to tell me that you, yeah. Come on, let's hook up. So we hooked up, called him. I said, what's up, man? He said, man, meet me at the gas station on Fondren. I said, all right, I'll be down in a minute. So we sitting at the gas station at Fondren. And I said, man, we ought to put a record out. He said, yeah, you jamming. We ought to do that. I said, well, when you want to do it? He said, right now, if you want to. I said, so you talking a record deal? He said, yeah, you got a record deal. Meet me at the studio tomorrow.
There's no way it just went that simple, man. You're telling me of all of these firsts that have happened to you and the way mm-hmm. that it has come into play, and right. now you're telling me that you connected with little Troy of Wanna Be a Baller fan.
Right.
H-Town right. Central. Man, that is tremendous. So from there, this was what, late 90s, early 2000s?
Yeah, we 2000, yeah, about 2001, somewhere around in there.
Okay. So yeah. From there, you went into actually creating music at that point on your own, correct?
Yeah, now we can
meet. A few albums out.
So now we got a couple albums out. We had one on Payday Records and Jay-Z then was there then also. One of the songs that I wrote with Schoolie is now on this soundtrack called Low Ball. It's a movie called Low Ball, right? Another, once again, the Abel Ferreira tie.
Right.
Abel hooked me up. He's like, hey, man, remember we worked back in the day? I got
going back spot. To the original. Yeah.
I'll put that out on Abel, and this is probably about the time I start writing.
Okay.
Scripts. Okay. This is when I start getting deep into the writing of the scripts and the writing of wanting to start. And this is where we get now to Hamilton Brothers Media. The reason we really put Hamilton Brothers Media is, man, we want to be able to tell our own stories.
Right.
You know? Right. When I first approached Hollywood with the Black Day story, they were afraid of it. It's too violent. They couldn't connect to it. The average Hollywood executive that that's not gonna be your partner. Y'all ain't gonna be boys. They're not gonna relate to everything that we relate to. And unfortunately, with Hollywood, they'll get a niche, they'll get a storyline, they'll get certain things that's gonna happen. You can sit there and watch a movie, be like, this getting ready to happen. He getting ready to die. It's just so cookie cutter.
I think I heard
that term before, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It's cookie cutter. So everything is just the same. So when we start trying to tell real stories that people can relate to and really want to watch, they're afraid of them because, one, they don't understand them, and they don't like them.
Right.
They don't like them, they don't understand them. This is not something I would watch. Well, television is not specifically for you.
Right, right.
Television to entertain the masses. Hollywood, they television is for them. No, it's for the masses. And my writing style, I like to write fictional stories, but I like to put some actual historical events that you can go look up and learn something from.
Yeah, truth-based fiction. Right, right.
I want you to be able to get, so I don't want you to sit there watching a Hamilton Brothers show for an hour, 10, and walk out and you didn't learn nothing. And it was just the same old, either some kind of animated stuff or super graphics.
Right.
Or that you just like, man, come on.
So it has some substance to what you're putting out there, right? Yeah. Yeah. So that kind of takes us into, you know, where we are today. So you went from writing lyrics and rap songs to basically writing scripts. And that kind of pushed you up to produce what you're working on right now, which is this concept series called Black Day. Can you explain a little bit about what Black Day is and what was your motivation, what it is that you're going to be doing with that?
Black Day, I really want to bridge the gap. What I've been seeing in the country right now, man, as far as race relations, everybody is kind of like pushing the needle of all we want to do is fight. There's right. No unity. There's nothing like that. All the brothers, all they want to do is gang bang and kill each other. I'm sick of that narrative, man. I'm so
False
sick
narrative.
Of hearing it. I'm so sick of hearing the story of the gang banger, dope dealer, and that's all he does in his lifetime. And there's no other substance to him. Like every person that you think is on the street right now that's gang banging sells dope.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
People have jobs. I want to see something, a realistic story about a cat that's in a gang that works at AT&T during the day, but he's banging the block. You'll never see that story in Hollywood because they don't want to talk about it. They don't want to tell, first of all, they don't know that story exists.
Exactly. That was what I was about to say. And see, Hollywood deals in fake reality. So if it's something that you're going to bring to them, that's actual reality, that's going to be based on facts, that you can actually tell a story, a lot of people are going to be, you know, kind of pushing back on that. But that's actually a pretty good thing, I think, because it seems like what you have out there now, there's a lot of interest in it. And it seems like people are following the story and reaching out, you know, to try to find out, you know, what's coming next with it. So what do you have coming down the line with Black Day, and what do you guys plan on doing with that?
So the strategy for Black Day is we want to keep it out as long as we can. We want to get as many viewers and subscribers and people interested in it so that we can take it to either a network or somewhere and put it out on a higher scale. The actual series is already written. What right. we did was we put out the first episode, kind of like a concept, not telling too much, so that people can get interested in it. So we can get the numbers up so then we can kind of negotiate with somebody putting out the whole series. What I don't want to do is just give it to somebody for some money. Then they come in and change the whole storyline, bring in their own characters and right. start changing what the whole point of Black Day is. The whole point of Black Day is for us to tell our stories and for us to be able to let people know that we have a different reality than what you're seeing coming out of Hollywood. Hollywood is just that, Hollywood.
Right, right. Yeah.
Okay. I want to be able to tell a story about, you know, everything you hear about is these boys that, you know, they this, that, and the other because they didn't have a father in the home. And they, what about the young brother who didn't have a father in the home, who maintained a household by working some kind of job, went to college, taking care of his family, and then you wonder why when an older gentleman comes and tries to give him some advice, you don't want to hear it.
Right.
Didn't nobody help me when I grew up. The only man I had in my house was me. So I don't need to hear no kind of advice from you. Who are you?
Right. Right. You know?
And I want to be able to bridge that gap to where they can let that anger off, but they can also hear from the 60 and 70 year old guys that are really trying to mentor. They really not trying to tell them what to do or what they should do with their life. Man, here's a couple of things that you might have missed. So let's just talk about it. I'm not coming at you, preaching at you. I'm just trying to throw some gems to another young brother that you can use as you go through this journey.
Something that's going to help.
I really want to bridge that gap, man, between the younger cats and the older cats, and us to really share this information, if they want it. You know, don't have to shove it down.
Put it out there and give it to them if they want it. Yeah.
All right, OG. Let me hear what you're talking about. It might be something I'm missing over there. It might be a little something that I still listen. I'm at my age. I still listen to cats 70, 80 years old now, and I still learn stuff.
Absolutely. So now I understand as well that you're not just going to be, you know, dealing with the stereotypical aspect of gangbanging and, you know, what people see is that you're actually going to be dealing with a lot of other social issues such as racism and, you know, especially now with CRT and the diversity and inclusion education or whatever all that stuff is. What's, you know, how are you going to address those things in Black Day and will that be a big component of the storyline that you tell?
That's going to be some of the storyline, but we also going to have an episode on Hamilton Brothers Media talking about race relations from the eyes of one family. Okay. And what we're going to do is we're going to interview a couple of cats in their 70s and 80s, and we're going to get out of the textbooks, and we're going to get out of the fake news arena and all of these things, and we're just going to talk to some cats that it actually happened to. And we're going to get some real stories from some cats, some of my uncles, to tell me when I was a baby and they was growing up, the first time they got segregated, bused to another school, and how my uncle dealt with Vietnam and how my dad dealt with my grandfather had physically seeing race. So our whole family has a story of race that I think everybody in this country has. And I don't think it's just Black people. I think it's white people. I think it's Hispanics, Puerto Ricans. I think everybody is at a point that they ready to heal. Like this race thing been going on and on and on and on. I really think everybody is at a point where they want to heal. Black Day is going to show some of the possibilities of how that healing can start. And it's also going to show real life stories from all sides of this racial issue. How Black people dealing with it, white people dealing with it, Puerto Rican people dealing with it, Italians, Indians, everybody has their own way of handling it and their own way of receiving it from other people. So it's going to be funny. It's not going to all be serious. You know, we're going to let you have a breather in Black Day. It's going to be funny. You're going to love the characters, but you're going to come away with something. You're going to be like, okay, I got one thing from that story today that was worth me sitting there for an hour watching.
So you're not going to just entertain. You're going to actually educate and bring some reality and make people think about some things, right? Because I always say, you know, I think most people in this country, especially, I think everybody kind of suffers from a sort of mental illness when it comes to racism, because it affects everybody. Mm-hmm. It affects everybody differently, but it affects everybody, and nobody is untouched, you know, whether it's directed at you or you're directing it at somebody else. So it's going to be good, man. I tell you what, I'm excited from what I've seen. And I know that it seems like there are a lot of people who are interested in and ready for, you know, the next episode to come out, man. So I look forward to what's coming down the pike, man. Anything you want to relate on or share with the people, Before we go,
the only thing I can tell y'all is right now we at close to 60-something thousand views. So I appreciate all the support from people, and I feel a responsibility to give y'all stories that you want to see, stories that are relevant, for you to take your time to watch a Hamilton Brother production. So there's a lot of responsibility with all the love that y'all giving us, and we take it seriously. And you guys just keep looking at Hamilton Brothers Network. I think you're going to really like what you're seeing, and I think you're going to get something out of it. So we looking forward to it, bro.
Absolutely, man. Well, it sounds like something, man. I don't say it sounds like it is something that's very much needed in what we're going into right now. And we're getting ready to go into this 2024, man. So things are gonna get even crazier going out there. So I think now is the time for something like this to be put out there. You know, that medicine that people can heal by. So
One thing I do
I'm
want to say,
excited for you.
one thing I do want to say before we go, man, is I hope people are taking this seriously. We really do need to come together. I don't care how. I'm glad that this may be a platform for us to start talking about it, but we need to keep our eyes on the government and Congress. They're changing a lot of things. They're rolling back a
Absolutely.
lot of laws. You gotta pay attention to what's going on, man. We can't just be in a fog and we can't keep fighting each other and tearing each other down. I can't say I'm the glue to pull people together, but I'm gonna do my best through this platform for us to be able to talk and heal and get prepared for these next coming years, man, because we got a lot of work to do. Because there's a lot of people putting in a lot of work to destroy y'all right now, and I hope you're aware of it.
Hey, and there you have it from the man himself, Mr. Fred Hamilton, CEO of Hamilton Brothers Media, creator of Black Day, the new concept series, guys. I hope you guys go out there on YouTube or whatever platform group you're on and check this out because it's something that, like I said, it's something that's needed. And I think you're gonna enjoy it. So I want to thank you guys, Fred, thank you for sitting down today and
Yes,
having this
sir.
conversation, man. And let's keep it
Yes,
moving,
sir.
brother. Let's keep it moving and let's give the people what they want. They want to hear the
At
song,
the
so
end of
let's
this
give it to them.
video, all the links are there at the end of the video if y'all want to check it out. So, man, much love to y'all, and we'll talk to y'all next time.
Peace.
Peace.